evening. Thank you for coming. Please excuse my casual dress. I literally just came from Boston, jumped out of my car, and ran. So the senator is scheduled to come tonight, but of course he too has, he's been up in Boston, and so he sends his regards. We'll be here. We both came, as you have, to listen. And he will, you know, he'll probably come in and sit quietly in the back and listen. I think there were a lot of very good questions the last time we met, and so we hope today to have some good answers. And if there are more, I know Holly was very, very aggressive about making sure that questions were sent in advance, and I think that's important, that there's plenty of time to prep and to think about these things. So without further ado, who will, she will end up introducing other people, but I want to introduce you to Elizabeth Schlesinger. And she has been working, she works for the environmental arm of the company. So I know that one of the big concerns the last time was about what the environmental impact was going to be. And so they are here today, as well as a representative from the implosion company. So please welcome them, and please raise your hands when you want to speak. And we're going to do the same thing that we did the last time. If you are here from Somerset, you get first crack at questions, then Swansea, and then people from outside of the area. So when you come up, when you ask a question, please identify your community. And again, please raise your hand, and let's not yell questions. Let's just have questions asked and answered, and we will try to be as succinct as possible, but also repetition may be good sometimes, but if the question has been asked, please don't re-ask it. So Elizabeth, to you.
All right, well, thank you again for coming tonight. I'm gonna apologize for sitting. I've got a bum knee and it's been acting up fairly badly today. Again, my name is Elizabeth Schlager, and I work for the environmental firm arm Enviro Analytics Group. Brayton Point LLC is a subsidiary of Commercial Development Company. I'm sure you've all read the newspaper articles. CDC has two arms underneath it, Environmental Liability Transfer Incorporated, and then Enviro Analytics Group LLC. ELT is the company that goes out looking for environmentally distressed properties that we might be interested in. Once those are brought in, so they did the brokering of the sale from Dynegy to our ownership. And then once the papers were inked, it became Enviro Analytics Group, their responsibility to do the environmental remediation of the site, secure permits, and help with the redevelopment efforts. So, and for the record, I want you all to know that I'm a homeowner of a very old home in an area of St. Louis that sits on top of an old coal mine. So I understand your concerns, and I'm gonna go through this presentation. We put it together based on questions from the last town hall that Steve Collins presented. In addition, we've taken questions that have come in through the website. Holly was very helpful in getting us basically Google Docs where you can log your questions. So we took all of these questions, and again, there was a lot of repetition. Lots of people have similar concerns. So we've used those. If you didn't get a handout when you came in, there are handouts up front. These are the official FAQs, frequently asked questions. If you live in the Point neighborhood, basically south of 103, close to the plant, you will be getting one of these attached to your doorknob probably tomorrow or Wednesday. They're also available on our website. And I know that the town of Somerset, and I believe even the town of Fall River and maybe Swansea also has a link to that on their pages. So we've tried to make these as accessible to everyone as possible. So I'm going to run through this presentation, and I'll ask you to bear with me. I think it will answer a lot of questions. When we get through the end, I will stay as long as there are questions, or until they start flicking the lights, which I think is at 9 o'clock. So anyway, Elaine, my handy assistant. All right, so one of the things that I want everyone to understand is that we've worked with an awful lot of organizations and entities to get to this point. We didn't just willy-nilly decide, you know, 2 weeks ago, hey, we're going to implode these, regardless of what anyone says. So we've worked with the towns of Somerset and Swansea, the city of Fall River. We've worked with the Massachusetts State Police, the local Swansea, Somerset, and Fall River police departments and fire departments. We've worked with the Harbor Masters, the U.S. Coast Guard's office. The Massachusetts Department of Transportation has been heavily involved in this. The Massachusetts of Department of Environmental Protection has also been heavily involved in this. National Grid, as you know, or may not know, but they have a large substation at Brayton Point. When the power plant was producing their 1,600 megawatts of power, it went straight into their substation, and then they've got transmission lines that come out. We've worked with Holly and the other, as the representative for the Board of Selectmen here in Somerset. We've also worked with Representative Haddad's office closely. Aside from Enviro Analytics Group, which is again the in-house consulting firm for the owners, Atlantic Coast Dismantling has been doing the demolition work at the site. Controlled Demolition Incorporated is our contractor who is responsible for the implosion efforts. GEI Consultants is our environmental and geotechnical firm here in Massachusetts. Northeast Traffic Control is the company that's going to be setting up the traffic control program associated with the implosion efforts in coordination with all of the local police departments and the state police. And then we've also worked with a firm out of Boston, VHB, who has been instrumental in helping us with getting our traffic permits and several other things. So there have been a lot of organizations and entities involved, and I just want you all to know this has been a collaborative effort on everyone's part. So the big news and the primary reason we're here tonight, we have three short chimneys that are on the south side of the powerhouse. Those are the ones that are going to be felled this coming Saturday on March the 23rd. Then, later, a month later, in April, on the 27th, the two cooling towers will be imploded and will come down. Both of those events, in the FAQ, it says in the morning, time to be determined. There was some going back and forth, do it at 8 a.m., do it at 10 a.m., but we've decided with input from the police departments involved and also the Department of Transportation that 8 a.m., or thereabouts, weather dependent, will be the times that we are aiming for. A lot of people have asked, are there things that could cause a delay? And we'll come to a slide that says that, but if there are weather delays, Sunday, the following Sundays to those Saturdays will be the backup days. The reason why it's that short a turnaround is the material that's been placed to do the implosions cannot be left in place. It has to be removed if it's not used. So that's the reason for those for the short time frame and the delay. So why were these dates chosen and when were they established? So for any, raise your hand if you were at the last town hall that Mr. Collins presented at. Okay, so that week prior was when we finally were all of those organizations were finally able to come to agreement on dates. So there wasn't anything being kept hidden. It wasn't like we knew for months in advance, these are the dates we're gonna do this. We literally, part of the reason for that town hall was to have a public announcement of those dates because we had just finalized them at the end of the previous week. We had to coordinate with CDI, and I'll introduce Tom in a little bit, but they do this kind of work not just all over the US, but all over the world. They have a very busy schedule, so a lot of it is trying to coordinate their opening dates. In addition, National Grid, who, if anyone needs to be concerned about what's going on, they are the ones to be concerned. We've done had extensive meetings with them, with Tom, with CDI involved, and they wanted, basically, we can't do anything that would impact their high peak timeframe of the year. And so that's why it's not being delayed further on into the summer to accommodate their schedule. Further, as far as the Saturdays being picked, we wanted to try and have as little impact to traffic as possible. So not just the locals, but people who are using I-195. And Saturday mornings are about the lowest traffic that you get. Provided there's not some event planned, which to my knowledge there is not. And also in the mornings, the wind direction is a lot more favorable than it is in the afternoons. So that's just, we're very fortunate that those overlapped. So on the day, both the 23rd of March and the 27th of April, here's what you all can expect. There will be U.S. Coast Guard and Harbor Master patrols in the water. The exclusion zones, which I'll get to in a minute, don't go that far into the water, but the Coast Guard and the Harbor Masters are all in agreement that they want to have a very wide berth, mainly for them to be able to go back and forth. But there will be maritime patrols. The Harbor Masters are going to deploy buoys the mornings of, so that anyone in a boat will know this is how close I can get and not any further. State and local police are going to be enacting the traffic control measures that Northeast Traffic is going to help us implement, and I'll get into that a little bit later. Local traffic will be allowed past certain checkpoints, but only local traffic and emergency vehicles. I know that one of the big concerns from the town hall meeting was what happens if someone needs, you know, an ambulance needs to come through, a fire truck or whatever. They will be able to go right through, whether it's a temporary road closure with a detour or the rolling roadblocks. I've been assured by the state police and by the local police that that is not an issue or a concern for anyone to have. So anyway, when we get close, and again, we're aiming for 8 a.m. on both mornings, at 2 minutes prior to the event, if you live close or you're at someone's house that's close, you may hear two long siren blasts. These siren blasts may be anything from an air horn to a police patrol car siren. At 1 minute before the event, a short series of blasts will occur, and then the implosion will happen. And then 5 minutes after the event about is when CDI will sound the all clear. So that will be one long blast, and then that's it. CDI is able to stop their countdown up to 10 seconds prior. So if for some reason, the police get an emergency call, someone's having a heart attack and whatever, if we have to, we can pause, we can put a pin in it and wait for that crisis to be dealt with. So I don't want anyone being concerned that if there's a medical emergency or something like that, emergency responders will be able to get to you and you will be able to get out without any problems. And then once that all clear signal has been issued, then the roads and waterways will be opened back up. Honestly, I don't know how long it will take the harbor masters to pick up their buoys, but that, however long it takes them, I'm not sure. So here starts another round of very common questions. Will there be flying debris that could hit my house or land in the roads? The answer to that is no, and not just no, but a very emphatic no. The cooling towers, the whole way that this design of the implosion is set is for them to fall into place. If you're familiar at all with the plant, you know that there are 40-foot tall, there's a 40-foot tall sound wall that goes around the entire perimeter of the cooling towers. 95% of the debris that falls is going to fall within those that sound wall. The only place that it's not, in this photo, you can see that there's a little dip as it goes around the cooling tower that's to the right and then comes to the left. There may be a little bit that falls in that area that's outside the wall, but that's going to be it. The chimneys are going to be felled like trees. So if you've ever chopped a tree down, timber, that's exactly what's going to happen with the short chimneys. They'll fall to the south in the direction that those arrows point and away from the powerhouse building. And then one of the reasons why you're not going to have flying debris is CDI, when they place the small amount of explosives that are used to weaken the structures in order for them to fall where they want them to, there's chain link fence to stop any large particle that might be going out. And they also have a flexible geotextile fabric that catches the small stuff. So it basically has some give. When that stuff comes out of there, it's going to catch it and stop that momentum, and everything is going to fall. As far as the cooling towers, they're going to basically lean slightly towards each other and come down. I'm going to show you all a video in a little bit that demonstrates what you can expect. So the next probably biggest topic is as regards the dust cloud. How big and what kind of dust cloud is going to occur? So anytime you have concrete rubbing against itself, you get dust. The towers are concrete. The towers were finished in 2012. They were started, I think the concrete pouring started in 2009. So that concrete's less than 10 years old. If you were to stand in the bottom of one of the cooling towers, everyone who's seen them has said, oh my, how pristine these are. Frankly, because they weren't used very long. So one of the things, and the chimneys are also made out of concrete. Two of them are lined with brick. There are two types of dust in this industry that gets discussed, heavy dust and lighter dust. The heavy dust is basically going to fall in place. The lighter dust is kind of the cloud of what you see, and it's just going to depend on the weather, what happens with that cloud. It's going to dissipate in 5 to 10 minutes. Tom, our CDI contractor who's here tonight, walked up to me before the meeting. He had just looked at the weather forecast and said, right now it's absolutely perfect condition for the chimneys this coming Saturday to have the absolute least effect on the residences, both on the point and Swansea on the other side, and nothing's going to get to Fall River. So the implosion, there are two kinds of demolition activities. We could do this with an implosion. It is scheduled, which means people are able to prepare for it. It's immediate, and it's short-lived. So these chimneys, once the explosion material is set off, the chimneys will be down in 6 seconds, and that's it. So for all of you who are planning watch parties or whatever, I just tell you, don't blink. If we were to do this by mechanical means, you know, whether excavators, a wrecking ball, whatever, if you go that route, you are still going to get the same, if not more, amount of dust. The difference is, it's a chronic, turns into chronic dust as opposed to acute one time, over and done with. And that's, you know, that's harder to protect the public against. It's harder to plan for from a cleanup operation. And doing this via the implosion method, it's over and done with right then. And so that's, there are so many benefits from a safety standpoint to doing it like that. And we did look at alternative measures, but this is by far the safest route to go. So and I do want you to know, so the dust has been such a concern. We are in the process of finalizing our air monitoring program that the DEP has asked us to put together. And we're going to be monitoring both upwind and downwind of the chimneys. And when we get to the cooling towers, because frankly, they're much larger structures, we'll have an upwind monitoring point and then probably two downwind points in two different places. And those points will be at the boundary of our property, so which is even more protective of the community because that's right there at the edge. So one of the things a lot of people have been talking, oh, and we will also collect those samples before, so we'll have the baseline, and then we will continue sampling after until we reach that baseline again. A lot of people have been concerned, you know, I've got asthma, I have this, I have that. If you have a respiratory illness and you are that concerned about your health and you have to make that decision, then we encourage you to close your windows and stay inside. That's really, keep your doors closed and keep your windows closed. That's really the safest way for you to be if you still have a concern over the dust, regardless of which way the wind is blowing. And we also encourage you, you know, everything should be finished by 9 a.m. So, how loud is this going to be? If you've ever gone to go see fireworks in person, that's as loud, if not louder, than what this is going to be. From where, basically, the decibel level, for the residents who live closest to the point, which I measured is 1,330 feet, it's probably going to be in the range of 125 to 135 decibels. So that's a loud thunderclap or fireworks. Again, it's going to happen like that. So if you're in the bathroom and you flush the toilet, I don't know that you're going to hear it. The chimneys, it's going to be about 6 seconds for the last of the chimney to hit the ground. The towers, the last piece of concrete, will be on the ground in about 8 seconds. Will there be vibrations that cause damage? Several people have wanted to know, what if this knocks the windows out of my house? You know, cracks in my foundation, that sort of thing. So the U.S. Bureau of Mines has established a large collection of safety criteria that CDI very strictly follows. The way that they measure these vibrations is in inches per second. So it's how much movement of basically the ground in this particular case is going to move back and forth. And anything, so the U.S. Bureau of Mines has established a safety threshold for anything that's less than two, if it's higher than 2 inches per second, that's when you might start to see loosening of paint or small plaster cracks. So, you know, if you've ever been in your house and a tree right next to you gets hit by lightning and there's kind of a shake, that's closer to what you're going to feel than what you'll feel with this. The nearest residence, again, we've measured is 1,330 feet away. And at most, they're going to get a half inch per second. So it's a fourth of what that criteria, that safety criteria is. And if you're further away from that, it will be even less. To safeguard, and so that we know this, and frankly, the data is collected, CDI uses it in their work. We'll have vibration sensors. How many? 10?
Eight.
Eight. We'll have eight vibration sensors all around the site, again, to monitor what that vibration frequency is. Okay, so can I and or my pets be outside to watch during the implosion events? If residents want to view the implosions from their yard or outside, you're welcome to do that. It's not necessary, but if you feel safer to wear a dust mask or hearing protection, that's your call and would be up to you all to provide. I will say that, so this is my dog. I had to put something personal in this presentation. So that's Rugby. And Rugby is not necessarily scared of loud noises, but he gets pissed off, and so he starts barking back at whatever the loud noises are. So the 4th of July happens twice in my house. If I lived anywhere nearby, he would be inside with the radio playing. If they're excitable or fearful, I would encourage you to keep them up. You and I can have this conversation, this dialogue, but I don't know about you, Rugby does not understand anything past the word treat. So again, if any resident for any reason is still concerned for their health or well-being as a result of these planned implosions, we just advise you to stay inside until 9 a.m. On the mornings of those implosions. So with the windows closed and your doors shut. What's going to happen to all of the debris from the cooling towers and the chimneys once they've fallen in place? So we're very fortunate that we can beneficially reuse that concrete on site as part of our grading efforts. There are a lot of dips and valleys at the site. We're going to need a fair amount of fill for those, and so that concrete's going to be crushed and beneficially reused on site. The rebar that comes out of it will go off in scrap trucks to be recycled. What could cause a delay of the implosion? So CDI is going to be monitoring the weather all week. Right now, again, it's looking like it will be perfect conditions. What could cause a delay, and this is probably more for the cooling towers, given the weather forecast right now, if there's an electrical storm or if there are winds stronger than 25 miles an hour, we will delay. And again, we'll be monitoring that. So leading up to the cooling towers, if it's looking like, you know, some terrible storm is rolling in, the whole thing will get postponed. We're not planning for that to be the case, we'll be keeping a very close eye on that. Will there be traffic control on area roads? Yes, indeedy. Because if you didn't know, if you weren't here, you were driving down the road and all of a sudden you're like, ah, because you see a bunch of, you know, these towers falling, that's a startlement. That's the only reason why we're having, well, that's not the only reason. A lot of the residents of the Point and surrounding areas are scared to death that they are going to get swamped with outsiders coming into their neighborhoods to watch this. That's why if you don't have a driver's license that has a local address, the police are probably not going to let you come in during a certain window. So on 23rd, the chimneys are not really that visible. I mean, you can see them in very fractious moments as you drive along some of the roads, but the cooling towers block them. The powerhouse structure itself blocks their view, and they're just frankly not as substantial or eye-catching. And really, the worst of it is going to be on I-195 coming west across the Braga Bridge. So we will have a rolling road block. That's going to start, I've got some maps, so I'll go through it, but the rolling road blocks will start over in the Fall River side of things and come west. And then once you get past a certain point, then it opens up. And the police, they've done this several times. This is not anything, this is not new technology or new ways to handle it. This is what they do on a regular basis when there's construction and stuff. For the day that the cooling towers come down, obviously that's a much, much bigger structure, much bigger deal with traffic, because frankly, they are the landmark for Somerset, whether you like them to be that or not. And if you don't like them to be that, congratulations, you're getting rid of them. So I-195 in both directions will have rolling road blocks. In addition, as far as local roads go, portions of Route 103 or Wilbur Avenue is going to be blocked off. There'll be police in certain locations, and again, emergency vehicles are going to be able to get in and out of this. They'll be able to blow through the rolling roadblocks. But part of the reason, another reason for this control with these rolling roadblocks, if you're thinking you might get on I-195 intentionally to get a good view, it's not like you're going to be able to pull over and stop. And there will be police, so when the rolling roadblocks start, there will be police in front of them who are going down the road to make sure that nobody has conveniently had a breakdown so that they can watch. So, I mean, if you legitimately have a breakdown, then you have a police officer there to help you. So anyway, they are going to be patrolling that fairly critically. And it's not just in Somerset. Over in Swansea, in the new Gardner's Neck Road community, there will be some police details. And again, if you're not a local and you don't have a driver's license to prove that you're a local, you're not going to be able to get past them at a certain point. I'm thinking probably, I don't know, we're having a meeting tomorrow with all of the police involved in the traffic control management plan to get timing down. So once we do, that will also go out so you all know. It won't be any sooner than an hour prior. So if you have doctor's appointments or whatever that you need to get to on Saturday, you should be able to do that. And if you want to leave, again, it's not those checkpoints. If you need to leave for some reason because you have an appointment to get somewhere, you'll be able to get out. So there are mobile traffic signs, and they've gone up. Derek, where are you? This is Derek. He's with Northeast Traffic Control. So they deployed a mobile sign. Yeah. Do you want to come up here and say that again so that everybody can hear you? I'll let you. I'll stand up and get out of your way. Hobble out of your way.
I'm sorry, I'm short.
No, it's all right. So we have 8 message boards throughout the area, Route 195, Route 24.
Hold the mic up, please.
All right. How's that?
Good. All right.
We have 8 message boards scattered throughout the area, Route 195, Route 24. They're all remotely programmable. We can change them, you know, kind of at the drop of a hat, on demand, so. In case we need to put up any additional warnings or things like that.
Yeah, when we get ready for the cooling towers, those mobile road signs will go back out, but it'll be 2 weeks in advance and there will be a lot more of them because frankly there's more roadway that's impacted with those. So thank you.
Thanks.
Okay. So, you all probably can't see this very well, and I apologize, but you do have a copy of it in your packet if you picked that up. So what this shows is I-195. The area that's in yellow is what's referred to as the view shed. It's where you can see the cooling towers really, really well. And the orange highlight and the yellow are where these rolling roadblocks are going to take place. So they'll start, originally, I'm not from here, and although I do have a degree in civil engineering, I went environmental and not traffic. But for Route 24, it feeds into 195, and the DOT requested that we start the rolling roadblocks prior to getting to 195 because there's so much traffic that feeds into it. So you don't want someone from Route 24 flying down the road and all of a sudden they hit a 10 or 15 mile an hour rolling roadblock. That would be bad. So we don't want any traffic accidents. Anyway, and then they're also going to be police detail at the entrance ramps that come onto I-195 along this route. So if someone is trying to get on the interstate, probably starting like maybe 10 or 15 minutes prior to the 8 a.m. implosion target time, you probably will just need to sit there and wait. They're not gonna let additional traffic onto the interstate during that time. This is a map that shows the local traffic control plan. So, this is Wilbur Avenue, this red, this long contiguous red, so Route 103. Brayton Point Rd comes into it, as does Lees River Avenue. So these dashes, and this is all the way down, I think it's Arch Street, if I'm not mistaken. When we were on our way over here, I looked specifically to try and make sure I knew the road where this was. This is where one of the checkpoints is starting, then right off of Route 6 for Brayton Point Rd and Lees River Avenue, and then over here at Gardner's Neck coming on. So they're gonna be police checkpoints there. In addition, the Somerset Police is gonna have other roving cars down in this area, mainly to make sure that nobody is parking on the bridge and that the folks who are already down here are behaving themselves. So, and then if you are someone who lives in Swansea, I don't know all those road names, so hopefully the map helps you out. But the bottom line is Swansea is going to have some control points of their own. So, because they fuss that, you know, they're the redheaded stepchild. I hear that there's a big 4th of July shindig and lots of people, this gets closed down and then Swansea winds up with all the spillover for the fireworks that happen in Fall River. Okay, so this map, I'm going to sit back down. So this is what the Coast Guard and the Harbor Masters are going to patrol. The exclusion zones, which you've got a map of in your packet, but I did not include here. They've really pushed this out. There's the only reason why they've pushed it out that far is because the Coast Guard don't want no shenanigans. So that's their decision and not ours. So basically, no boating inside that semicircle that basically goes from the bottom of the Gardner's Neck point all the way over to, I don't remember the name of the public park or the public beach that's over there. But and then where Wilbur Avenue or Route 103 goes across Lee River, you won't be able to come any further south right there. And again, I think that they're planning to start enforcing these maybe a half hour, certainly no more than 1 hour ahead of the implosion. And once it's over with, then you guys will be allowed to pass. So one of the things, and again, I'm going to show you a video in just a second. I don't want you all to feel like you have to be outside to watch the big show because it's going to get recorded. We have a company that has does drone flyovers for our site on a regular basis. If any of you all have gotten on the BraytonPointCommerceCenter.com website, in the media gallery, you've seen some of the shots that we've gotten from our drone footage. And so they're going to be recording the implosion event. I'm sure that our media representatives will be somewhere. So there are going to be a lot of people out recording it. And I know that there's a company in town, Southeast Aerial. I don't remember exactly, but I'm sure that there are folks who are going to be using drones, whether they have a company that does that or they're hobbyists. If you are a hobbyist, you do not want to get very close with these little things. Ours are going to be at a significant height and distance, we don't take responsibility for damaged drones for any of this. So, but we will have that. So now we're going to play you a video. CDI imploded two similar cooling towers in Jacksonville, Florida, last year, and this is it. Lots of different shots from different angles played several times. This video is also on our website. If it's not there yet, it will be there tomorrow. Buildings. A lot closer there than any residence is going to be. And just like at Brayton, they had an active substation next door. So they're falling straight down. That's what's going to happen. And that's just a few minutes afterwards. Birds flying. What you see, those are water cannons that you saw that were kind of spraying stuff. So anyway, that's what you can expect. That it's going to look like that. This replayed the same thing several times in this video. The reality is not going to be that long. So you saw how quickly they went down. If someone does think that they have somehow sustained damage to their homes, then we would like for you all to send the same type of information you would send to your own insurance agency, proof of the damage, photographic evidence, and a brief description. Any estimates that you may have gotten for a repair, and then the name, address, and contact information for the owner who's requesting compensation. And then info@BraytonPointCommerceCenter.com. I really apologize for the fact that the email address is really long. I don't know why they didn't do BPCC, but that's not my department, so. Anyway, and or there's also a contact us feature on the website as well. So. If anybody thinks that they've got a reason for a claim of some sort, that's how to get in touch with us. And then this is our address. A lot of people wanted to know, who are these people? How do we get in touch with them? Here's our mailing address, phone number, again, BraytonPointCommerceCenter.com and info@BraytonPointCommerceCenter.com. And now, that's my canned speech and my presentation. So I would like to offer up for anyone who's got questions, unless Tom, you wanna say a few words before they get into it?
I can.
Okay.
Just to reiterate a couple of things.
Oh, do your
folks. There's a couple of them. My name's Tom Dowd. I'm the field operation manager for controlled demolition. I've been doing this for 29 years now, so I've heard all your questions, and I hope we can make you all feel comfortable. A couple of the questions about vibration when you look at the size of these structures. You have to remember, we're not going to take these structures, pick them up, turn them over, and drop them. The chimneys and the cooling towers as cylinders, first the chimneys, as they come over, that cylinder, as it starts to come back to the ground, it becomes compressed. It uses its own energy to become its own shock absorber, so all that weight isn't hitting all at once. Same with the cooling towers. If I were to take a 5-gallon bucket of sand and, you know, drop it on the step here, you'd get a thump. Well, what we're going to do is we're going to take the same 5-gallon bucket of sand and we're going to pour it. So we move the same volume of material, it hits the ground over time, doesn't create so much vibration. The second question we get is, again, the use of explosives. All we need to do with the use of explosives is we wish to displace the concrete, deflect the rebar, and let the weight of the structure do the work. Less than a couple of hundred pounds here at the chimneys, a little bit more on the cooling towers, again, based upon their size. But again, the analogy we like to use, we've all done it when we were kids, if you stand on a Coke can, it'll hold your weight. The minute that you tap the sides, that can collapses. Or if when you're a kid, you come up and tap somebody in the knee. That's all that we want to do. Displace the concrete, deflect the rebar, let gravity and the weight of the structure do the work. We do create vibration. We will have 8 seismographs set up for this event, 12, I believe, for the cooling towers. Like I said, the ground vibration is going to be minimal. We'll have it recorded at those 8 and 12 locations, and then we can extrapolate through a third party who will be setting those seismographs up for us for both events beyond their actual location. They've monitored both vibration and sound. So we can take care of, again, anything from cracked foundations to if you believe that you have broken windows. The question about the sound is the detonation of explosives. You're going to hear one big bang. That's all the human ear is going to hear. Actually, what's going to happen is all 3 structures for the chimneys are going to be detonated at 3 different times. And each of those chimneys have 3 legs. Each of those legs have rows of columns placed in them. Those will be detonated at separate times. So while we may have a couple hundred pounds of explosives in the chimneys, I'm anticipating no more than probably 5 to 7 pounds going off at any one given time. And what that is it at 8 milliseconds, if you have 2 detonations within 8 milliseconds, that pressure wave can catch itself and amplify. Anything over 9 milliseconds, that can't happen. We extend it, we're using 17 milliseconds here. So those air waves will never catch up, never amplify. Keeps down the noise, you can't really hear it, but the science says it's there, and the vibration. Those are the main things we like you to know.
To speak to CDIs, so they don't advertise much, because they don't have to. They've been in business for 70 years. It is a family-owned business. The same family that started it is the ownership and who runs it today. It's all they've ever done. Every hotel in Vegas that's been dropped, if you've ever seen videos, they're probably the ones that have done that. The cooling towers that you just watched was one of their jobs. If you get on YouTube, Controlled Demolition, Inc., look that up, and they have a beautiful YouTube channel that's got all kinds of stuff, all kinds of implosion efforts that they've done. So they have been in this business a long time. They are the experts. We're very, very happy that they're on board with us and that they are the ones doing this job for us. I know that one of the questions I think that came in was, who do you have doing this? I hope it's not the Yahoos that did blah, blah, blah. I don't remember, some disaster. Implosion's gone wrong. That's not these guys. So they're very, very good at what they do. They don't advertise because they don't have to, because their work speaks for itself. And anybody who's anybody in the construction business who needs to take something down knows who these people are. So we're very, very fortunate to have them being the contractor who's doing this for us. They're very, very experienced. So. And again, he's got gray hair. If you're bad at that job, you're not going to be doing it for long.
All 10 fingers.
Anyway, yeah, so thank you very much, Tom. And I guess we'll open the floor up. So
Somerset people first. If you have a question, please stand up, give your name and address. And I just want to say that the senator has joined us, the education of a lifetime today. Yes.
If you all could please kind of keep your chatter down so that we can hear the person asking the question, I'd appreciate it.
I don't live in the area, but I have an elderly father that lives on New Brayton Point Road or Gardner's Neck Road in assisted living.
Excuse me. You're the one in Somerset?
Yes.
Or the one in Swansea?
Oh, he lives in Swansea.
Okay.
I live in Somerset.
Oh, okay.
Okay. So my question is, sometimes I have to see him on a short term, very short notice. When will access to that neighborhood be actually shut off and reopened as far as driving?
So again, that's one of the things that we're going to figure out at the meeting tomorrow that we're having with all of the police. So that information will get published. We'll make sure that all of the media has it, and we'll have it on our website. So if you've between the media and our website, I'm hoping that you'll be able to access that. I don't know if one of the local police chiefs would like to address their thoughts, or Derek.
As far as
Chief?
Local is concerned, I don't know if it's going to be very temporary, it's going to be very short, so hopefully in a small period of time. Sorry, can you hear me?
No.
So I'm addressing this gentleman here who had a question.
I'll repeat.
So any road closure is going to be very short term. It's not going to be, an hour, it's going to be 2 hours, it's going to be a few minutes, if at all. The rolling roadblock on 195 is probably the biggest headache for anybody that's traveling through town. It's because they have to roll through side across, and might be able to address more, because he's doing the operational plan.
With respect to the road closures, as Elizabeth said, we're finalizing, the final determination will be tomorrow, but again, as stated earlier, the biggest reason and one of the biggest concerns that the residents of the Point have expressed is the gawk factor and people flooding the area, causing a traffic problem and concerns that with those traffic problems, safety vehicles wouldn't get in, it wouldn't be able to get into the neighborhood. So as a result of those concerns, we plan, as it stands right now, it could change tomorrow, hopefully it doesn't, but we plan to close the Brayton Point neighborhood to only residential traffic 1 hour prior to the designated demolition time. So if it's gonna go off at 8, we're gonna try to close down Brayton Point Road at the 195 overpass 1 hour prior to that, okay? If you live in that area and you wanna leave, you're certainly not gonna have a problem. If you need to get into the neighborhood and you live there, you're not gonna have a problem as it stands right now, the plan is until we open the rolling road blocks, then out of an abundance of caution for everything, we want to shut everything down at that point, and that's probably going to be no more than 12 minutes prior to the blast. So at the most, if you're going to be inconvenienced, it's going to be about 12 minutes. That's the way it stands right now. In an emergency situation, we will have a roving patrol within the Brayton Point neighborhood, designated simply for response to any type of emergency that will occur in your neighborhood. The remaining patrol that would normally cover that area will be able to cover its normal assignment, but we will have designated one patrol vehicle to respond to any emergency that will that could possibly take place within that area. And as Elizabeth said, we have been assured that if any calamity should happen, if there should be a house fire or any type of major emergency, that we can stop that explosion within 10 seconds of it actually happening. So as far as that is concerned, that's the plan for this Saturday. Yes, ma'am.
The person that's going to be patrolling, are they an EMT or something along that line?
that's going to be able to address an emergency health-wise?
I can let the fire chief speak to that. I believe he has a plan for that.
Yes, for both events, we will have both an engine company and an ambulance detailed to the point for point responses only. And we will still have available coverage for the remainder of the town.
They'd be on the south side of the overpass?
So right now, the command post is going to be somewhere near the entrance of the power plant, which is where we will stage the... So right now, the command center will be right near the entrance to Brayton Point. We will have an engine and an ambulance within that area. So no matter what, if you can let me finish, please. No matter what, we will be able to go out Brayton Point Road. If not, there is a secondary means of egress, which is Hebb Street. We have access to the gate.
You do?
We do. And we will open that if that's necessary. That goes to an access road that leads directly to Route 195. That will be available no matter what. So there will always be two ways to get out of the point. And we will have emergency vehicles dedicated to that area.
So is it at Brayton Point at Route 6, or is it at Brayton Point at Route 103?
Be right near the entrance to the power plant. Right near the entrance to the power plant.
South of the overpass?
Correct. Yes.
Now, when I went down on Saturday to look at Hebb Street is locked. There's a basketball net in front of there.
There is nothing blocked. I was there about 3 o'clock this afternoon. It's completely clear. And again, I have a key for the gate. So there is not an issue there.
You're there.
Yes. I don't know where that is. The link. Go to the beginning.
Eastern.
Or actually, right here. That's good. So that 1,300 feet is right here. This corner. So the house that's closest to the site, is that where you're talking about?
Yes.
Yep. Well, then you're it. You're 1,330 feet. Somerset?
Yes. Bobby Lample, Beach Street, Somerset. My question is, will this have any effect on the gas main?
No, it will not. So for those of you, used to be Algonquin and now I believe it's Enbridge, we've notified them. They're not concerned for any of this. They said they'll probably have a truck out there just to double check, but they're aware of this. None of your utilities are going to be affected, whether it's the natural gas line or your water line or your sewer. That is not something that is of a concern.
Yes.
Stephen Dean, Somerset. I'm asking about immediately west of the number 2 cooling tower, within a couple of hundred feet, underground are 2 pits. And I'm just curious, the material that's in those pits, is there any chance that there could be structural damage to those pits, letting that material leak out?
No, so the plant has a very sophisticated stormwater drainage system, and except for water that falls and sheds immediately into Lee River, everything that's interior all comes into the center of the plant. It all goes down to what's referred to as the lower supply basin. If it doesn't go there, there are some other catch basins around the site that are valved, and we've got those closed. And that's been the way, that's been the case throughout demolition.
Are you telling me that the material in those pits cannot be released?
No, it
can't. Okay, because I was responsible for dumping some really ugly stuff into those pits.
Yes.
You tell the chief that.
Thanks.
Yeah, the landfills are closed as well.
Yeah, it was capped over back in the 1980s.
Yeah.
It closed.
Yep.
But that material is still in the ground.
Yep. And it's not going anywhere. It's contained.
Okay.
Yes, Mr. Are you going to have a special breakfast? I'm there.
The traffic information that will be decided tomorrow, will that information be available to the public and our local businessmen who will be affected by the closures of the road?
Yeah.
Good timing. I was just going to address that.
Cool.
Thank you.
So we're going to meet tomorrow with Swansea State Police, other agencies, Fall River, to finalize the plan. We have a draft right now. The draft was presented to the board and the town administrator today. And we're going to finalize that tomorrow. Once it's finalized, I just spoke to Sergeant Koss about that. I'll probably post that on social media. We'll blast that out everywhere so everybody has an operational plan, so everybody knows exactly what's going on, and and hopefully they can share with people that might not have social media. Hopefully they can do that. The other thing I want to address too is there was concern about any medical emergencies that might go on. All of our police cruisers have automated external defibrillators and oxygen, and all of our officers have to be first responders or at least EMTs. So I wouldn't be concerned about that because our officers are excellent first responders. So no concerns with that, and hopefully we'll have that. Once it's finalized, we'll have the operational plan on social media, and we'll give it to the media if needed tomorrow. Okay?
Somerset? Swansea? No. Swansea?
Oh.
Yes.
How much water are you going to be using for dust abatement?
Russ, do you want to speak to that? How much water are we going to use for the dust abatement? So what we will do is, prior to the felling of the chimneys, supposedly maybe there's a 50% chance of rain, but we will thoroughly wet the area where the chimneys are going to fall ahead of time. And we will also have what is in the business referred to as a dust boss. It's basically a gigantic water cannon that will be in use prior to, during, and after.
So you really don't know?
I just don't know how many gallons of water those things move.
3,600. How are you able to absorb that?
Yes.
The water we did in the cooling tower, the working plan is that there's a cooling basin underneath the cooling towers, and we're gonna put water in that cooling in the cooling basin that will help suppress it. Okay.
Everybody's mumbling.
So the working plan for water for dust suppression, there's obviously the chimneys, the first event. The area will be wetted ahead of time, obviously to ensure it's saturated. As Elizabeth said, we have stormwater controls on the site, so it'll be maintained on the site. There will be sprinklers or dust bosses that will be active during that event. But it's again a short-lived event, 10-minute event at the most until the dust is done, so we're not looking at an excessive amount of water use. For the cooling towers, the working plan is that the cooling towers themselves have a basin, and we're going to make sure that there's water in that basin where the debris is intended to fall, and that's going to be an effective dust suppression device, along with the sound wall, which itself is 40 feet high. So between those two, and we're going to try to wet the entire surface again within the sound wall, have water within the cooling tower basin to be able to suppress the dust.
Okay, you're saying three chimneys. What about the fourth one?
The fourth chimney, we're working on that plan right now with the department, Massachusetts department, and we do not have a plan finalized for the fourth chimney. So that is going to, most likely at this point, is going to occur at a later event. So we do not have a plan finalized for that.
Another disruption like this?
It's unclear at this point. The fourth chimney, as we have some additional work to do on the fourth chimney. It could be much later in the year. We're not sure at this point in time.
Now,
but that's accurate.
The water stack is 60 years old. Two is 55 down to 30 on unit 4. There's going to be a lot of dust with those coming down. There should be more dust because of the age of the structure and the cement and whatever they use to build it. Because they're brick lined and
yes.
cement.
Yes. I mean, dust is unavoidable during demolition. We do understand that. We're tempted to do what we consider to be the best management practices for dust for the chimneys.
Other questions?
One of the things, I want to speak to this before I forget. So the plant actually, we are using water. It's not like there is no water at the plant. We've got a whole series of fire hydrants that go around the outer perimeter of the site that have water going to them right now. So the town, they're aware of our water usage. It's not going to be what's considered excessive usage, again, except for this 15-minute period. It's the basin that the water used to be in when the cooling towers were in operation.
Yes, that basin is, when the plant was in operation, that was continuously fed.
Yeah, we are going to block it. You're right, there are some outlets where water can escape. We're going to sandbag.
There's a game on that.
We've got a plan in place to make sure that the water stays in the basin. Yep.
Other questions? Yes.
Are you going to be testing any water afterwards around? Because I live literally right next to the Lee's River, right across from the demolition site.
Are you talking about, are we going to be testing Lee's River water?
Are you going to be testing any water?
No, that is not. No.
So if the water leaks into Lee's River, there'll be no testing after that?
So the water from the dust suppression will stay on site. So again, there's a very interconnected series of stormwater drains when the plant operated. Those are still there, and we use them. So when we've got water from our other demolition activities, all of that stays on site and goes into settling basins, and so it does not go out into the bay or the river.
Also, is there going to be any protection for the wildlife in the area prior to the implosions? Because we see it all around the house.
So, Tom, I don't know where you went.
I don't think we have wildlife on site.
Yeah, I mean, the wildlife on site may consist of a fox or two. I don't know. I don't know, and there may be. I know that there are some turkeys that I've seen, but as far as
okay, excuse me. She's trying to answer questions. People are talking, people can't hear the questions, and you're not getting the information. So I'm asking you please to stop your private conversations and listen. The question was about the wildlife. So I'm sorry, Elizabeth, would you repeat that, please?
So right now, we do not have a wildlife protection plan. There are no, there's no protected species, I guess. The closest thing that we have is a bat that goes back and forth across the site. We actually did look this up to speak to your question. And that's one of the things that we had to declare and look up before we move forward with this plan.
Great, thank you very much.
Questions? Yes, sir.
In the back.
Madam, sorry.
So what we're going to do, there will be some sampling done prior to the implosions, and the samplers that we have collect samples every 5 seconds. Our consultant who's going to be doing that is GEI Consultants, and they will have a report that they give to us,
We're going to monitor.
Yeah, I mean, we'll monitor that. The DEP will be getting a copy of that. So if there's anything of concern, I'm sure that will be made public.
Thank you.
I don't think that we had planned on doing that. We'll have a conversation with the town and the DEP and figure that out. Anybody else?
Other questions?
Sir?
The plant has been in operation for a long time. And in that time of operation, they had a hard time containing coal dust from shale coal that was piled on site. I have a hard time believing that we're going to be able to control the dust from the tallest towers ever built to not cover our property, not just the homes, but the grass, the pools, the kids' toys, and things like that. That's my concern, and I'm sure a lot of others is. We've dealt with coal dust mitigation over the past half a decade. We're just concerned that, I understand this is going to be a short, quick, and brief event, but we've experienced what being covered with finite dust can do. And that's just a concern that I know I have, I'm sure, that we have an agency.
Yeah, well, so to speak to that, that's absolutely a concern. If I lived in your neighborhood, I would have it as well. One of the differences to keep in the back of your mind are, my mom is an English teacher and she would be fussing at me about my grammar. The operation of the plant was 24/7, okay? And 760,000 tons of coal in that pile at its heaviest peak. So that's, you know, to use a technical term, a crap ton. And we're not gonna have, those cooling towers are nowhere near that volume. And again, the issues that you all had in that neighborhood, that pile was there in operation on a regular basis around the clock through all manner of weather. Regardless, you know, it's not like they'd shut it down if there were gale force winds. That coal was still sitting there.
We also have sprayers that were running 24/7 to combat the dust, and that didn't accomplish it either.
Right. But again, I just want you to think about the volume of coal versus what we are going to generate. So the gentleman back here in the corner is correct. The chimneys that are coming down are old. The first one was built in 59 or 60, and the tall one was built in 1974. So they are old. There's no getting around that. And you know, they are going to generate dust. But they, in terms of the size, you know, relative to the cooling towers, they're very small. The cooling towers are very small compared to the dust or the coal pile that was there. So I don't think, we have zero expectation that that you all are going to see anything like what you saw when the plant was in operation. So.
Questions? Yes.
You're also closing that off. Is there anybody that can assure us that we'll be able to, if we have an emergency?
Oh, yes, ma'am.
That you're going to be stationed?
Absolutely. So in the packet, if you got a copy of that, if you didn't, I think there are a few more. So it's the same deal with Swansea as it is with Somerset. The locals will be able to come and go. Up until probably about an hour prior. So if you have friends who are coming in.
I wouldn't want my friends to read that.
Oh, okay. So as far as emergency vehicles, they're gonna have full access. There's not gonna be any barricade stopping any emergency vehicles coming in and out. For the residents that live, yes.
Down in that area.
Swansea's got, I think.
Are you talking about Somerset or Swansea?
Swansea.
Swansea. Okay.
From Church Street all the way down to the end of the point, there is no way of getting off. You're closing from Church Street down to Wilbur Avenue 103. Somerset, you've got the reassurance that someone's going to be there.
I'm just saying, you don't have anybody from Swansea here reassuring us that if there's a problem in our neighborhood, then we're going to be have it addressed.
They knew about the meeting. I don't, did you speak to them?
We have been in meetings. It's been full collaboration between all of the entities, as Elizabeth stated in the beginning of the presentation. The Swansea Chief of Police and his designees have been at all of these meetings. They have a traffic plan. I'm trying to reassure you as best as I can that they also have a plan in effect that will provide for the safety of their residents. There will be numerous Swansea police officers in the area for the same reasons that I explained in Somerset. Okay, I hope I was able to at least put your mind at ease that there is a plan in place. And if you have any specific questions, I direct you to the Swansea Police Department, and you can ask them specifics on that.
Okay. Yeah, there right now, there are 5 Swansea police details specifically just for this event that are going to be stationed in certain areas that are designated on the map that you've got.
I know.
Okay. No, you can't get out, ma'am. They're not going to stop anyone from leaving.
How about getting in?
Getting in, if you live there on your driver's license, if you have an address for any of those neighborhoods, you'll be able to get in. Nobody's going to be stopped if they live down there. And again, this is going to be, you know, for the hour, it's around 7 a.m. until right after 8 a.m., after the implosion. Other questions?
Yes, ma'am.
My name is Susan Brass. I have a question that was brought up at the last meeting from Steve Collins, mentioning that there are going to be 53-foot length trucks bringing in the stuff that's going to be retrofitted for the windmills. And I just wondered, how are those trucks going to be getting up and down 2-lane highway? I know you had some traffic people, but how does that affect our overpass again? I know the fire department says that we've got an egress out.
Excuse me, do you think that those are coming for the implosion?
No.
Oh,
no.
Okay.
This is something that was brought up in the last meeting.
So, sure. So, first of all, I think it's important to understand that the wind industry components that are going to be coming to Brayton Point and then leaving from are actually coming via boat and exiting via boat.
In and out?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
That was not the case when he was talking about it at the last meeting. He was talking about really big trailers coming down.
But, excuse me.
Okay.
And with that lady's concern, I was wondering, is everything going to be closed? If they're coming in and out by the water?
So we're following the DOT regulations for all of the traffic, regardless of size, that comes in and out of the plant?
That's what I'm trying to say. If you're bringing in big stuff on big trailers, it's going to affect the traffic for the people that live in the Brayton Point neighborhood.
Right. At whatever point, If there's something that requires, you know, lead trucks or follow trucks or whatever, you know, when they're moving mobile homes down the interstate, you see the lead cars and follow cars. Anything that is going to happen is all going to be done per DOT laws. So we're not going to do anything that's illegal or anything like that.
So, excuse me, that is very much in the future.
Well, it is. It is, but as I said before at the last meeting, I knew nothing about the first meeting. The communication has got to get better. The only place that I saw information was on our town Facebook.
So my neighbor said she got a rowboat call.
Hungry?
I want more information about people that are coming in, out of business, to know that they're being vetted.
So. Yeah, nothing is going to be done that the town administration doesn't know about, that the DOT doesn't know about, and I totally understand. So we're trying to, you know, have more of a presence with our website. We've worked with Holly McNamara, who's the head of the selectmen board, and also with the town, with having information available there, also in Fall River and Swansea. So we've now started including them, you know, with all of our information. So we hope to be doing a much better job with communication. We hear you that you did not hear us. So I got that.
Questions on the implosions? Yes.
That honestly is not our department. I can point you to Pat for that.
Right now, Auclair's Market, Annie's, anybody who's one of the Marine, Bruce Aldridge Marine Corps League, I have some in my office, the Senator has some, just leave a message, we'll get them to you. Questions?
Anything else?
Somerset, Swansea.
Fall River?
Yes, go ahead, Joe.
Joe Powell. At the previous two meetings, I had addressed some environmental concerns, so it's wonderful to see you, Ms. Schlager, and thank you for responding to my questions that were posed online.
Oh, you're welcome.
So,
proof positive that we've done our best to try and pay attention and respond to folks who send in questions.
So I have two questions. I'm not sure if anyone is here from the Mass DEP, Department of Environmental Protection.
No.
Yes.
Thank you.
Oh, good. Great.
So my question for you, Ms. Schlegler, is when were they contacted about the implosion?
Oh, God. Millie, I don't remember when we.
Sure. So, good evening. My name is Millie Garcia Serrano. I serve as the regional director for Mass DEP in the Southeast region. We're in the Lakeville office. Mr. Carvalho, as you know, we've had some conversations. Back on June 8th, 2017, the prior owner of the company came to visit us and basically talked to us about this plan. Not in a lot of details because the purchase and sale agreement had not gone through. However, as Elizabeth has described, there are a number of permits that are needed in order to proceed with this implosion, particularly the air quality 06 permit. So we've been working hand in hand for the past probably 3 weeks.
We submitted a permit. Yes, Kazoom Tight.
Thank you.
The first one was submitted months ago, and as things have developed, Millie's air quality division got in touch with us, and so we've been working with them hand in hand very diligently to get an air, and in fact the town requested that we do air monitoring, so they asked and we've hopped pretty fast.
Right.
So
the plan basically consists with regards to asbestos surveying. 38 samples were collected from the stacks. No detections.
Could you, Millie, could you come to the
sure. Good evening. My name is Millie Garcia Serrano, and I work for Mass DEP. We're housed in Lakeville. Mr. Carvalho, as you and I have talked about, we got involved back in 2017, anticipating that this at some point could potentially happen. There was discussion with regards to landfills, with regards to water quality, with regards to federal permits associated with the stormwater system that Elizabeth has described. In general, over 20 environmental components were described and discussed. More specifically though, as we learned that this implosion was gonna be occurring, we signaled to the company that there was an a very specific air quality permit that needed to be filed. That permit is the air quality 06 permit, which basically touches on ensuring that there are no constituents of concern or contaminants of concern in the material that's going to be imploded. Specifically, the things that are being covered as part of the survey include the asbestos survey. We requested samples, both for the cleaning, the cooling towers as well as the chimneys. Specifically, asbestos was sampled, and no detections, basically the analytical results demonstrate that there are no detections of that particular parameter. We also require a site plan, a dust control plan that includes wetting procedures, pre-wetting, wetting during the implosions, and post-wetting. Wetting equipment, such as water cannons, the dust boss that was described, fire hoses, water containment, runoff controls, particulate matter, perimeter air monitoring as well. On-site wind measurements, as well as stop criteria. So we have a whole bunch of different things that basically comprise this permit. Everything has been filed and in order, and tomorrow we'll be doing another review of additional incoming material that came into us at 4:40 this afternoon. But as far as we're concerned, environmental quality is met with regards to the performance standards that are set forth by the air quality regulation.
So one of my concerns as well, and I think I had emailed you, about the particulate matter going into the Taunton River and Mount Hope Bay, and subsequently out to Narragansett Bay as well. So I'm not sure if Ms. Schlegler or your office addressed that. Is that part of your assessment?
So yes, so there is going to be, as Ms. Schlegler described, there is going to be some sort of dust associated with this implosion. It's inevitable. However, there's going to be the heavier dust that will, as described, basically end up on site. That's 95% of the dust. Any remaining finer dust is not likely to reach the water. We are pleased with the fact that the implosion will occur at 8 o'clock in the morning. Basically, that's the most favorable wind away from any kind of neighborhood, and we understand that the wind conditions will be favorable at 8 o'clock in the morning. In the afternoon, the wind basically shifts the other way, and that would be detrimental to the community, so I'm pleased with regards to the selection of the time frame for the implosion.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I just want to make a statement as well that while aesthetically these towers are abysmal, obviously, I don't think I need to convince anybody of that. However, the purpose that they served in cooling the water after the coal was burned, rather than throwing 95 or 98 degree water into the Taunton River, Mount Hope Bay, and Narragansett Bay, caused the state of Rhode Island to sue the company for basically poaching winter flounder eggs, and how decimated the winter flounder were by that water going in from the plant. So while we're glad to see the implosion of the water cooling towers, they served a tremendous purpose for the environment of Mount Hope Bay, Narragansett Bay, and the Taunton River. So thank you very much.
You're welcome. I didn't have anything to do with that.
So. Questions?
Okay.
Other questions? Seeing none? Oh, was that a hand, or was that just a stretch? Okay. All right, seeing no further questions, thank you.
Can I say something, Pat?
Sure.
I would like to thank you guys for really doing a nice job of explaining. At this meeting, I think it was just probably about 500% better than the last time we had.
Yes, it was.
So, really a big thanks to you.